What we like to do and what we dream about has been a huge inspiration for people all over the world. This mission is dangerous. Most of my friends think that this is crazy and equally inspiring. The goal of Copenhagen Suborbitals is to put a human being in a space capsule on a rocket, fly him 100 kilometers up in the air so that he can come back and tell us what he has seen and experienced with his own eyes. That is the ultimate ride. Why are you doing this? We get that question a lot. To be honest, the best answer I can come up with is why not? We are in the Copenhagen Suborbitals workshop on the old abandoned shipyard in Copenhagen. What we do here is we build rockets. We have a collection of stuff that used to be rockets, some successful, some less successful. Electronics, huge diesel engines. We have at least 10 projects going on, but the biggest one is the Nexo II rocket that we will launch this summer. We are starting to build bigger rockets. We are starting to build a prototype of our first manned space capsule.
Right now we're standing outside our main workshop where there's a lot of activity going on today, where we have what we affectionately call our GOAT, good old British front loader, that we use for basically moving everything heavy about the workshop. 80% of rocketry is actually infrastructure. Moving heavy object A from point one to point two and back again. Over here, making a lot of noise, is Sheila. She is currently working on the prototype for the next generation space capsule. That's roughly the size of the can where we're going to put a person inside and then launch on this 100 kilometer suborbital trajectory. Of course, it'll have windows and steering and things like that, so that you can actually decide, do I want to look at the stars or do I want to look at the ground while you're 100 kilometers up?
This is a mock-up of our space capsule, so we can design where the controls go. Martin, his mock-up of the chair, we fit in here, make sure everything fits, and we continue the design down to like what life support should the astronaut have, where should his bottle of water be, if he should have water with him up, or if we're just going to make him drink some water before he launches. We need to have a mock-up so that we can test everything before we put a lot of energy into the real deal.
That is Randy, our crash test dummy. We use him in all our launches where it makes sense to have a person substitute inside, which so far I think we only managed to kill him what, two or three times. He has a very cool attitude about it. As you can see, he's not moving about much. He's cool with it. The thing I'm standing right behind here is a capsule for the first rocket that we launched way back in 2011.
Yes.
Woo!
It was the first major rocket that Copenhagen Suborbitals launched.
We're going supersonic.
Woo!
It flew to 3-4 kilometers roughly. And then unfortunately, because of a manufacturing error, it was flying sideways. So the flight was terminated.
We can confirm we've had separation and parachutes deploying and commencing recovery operations.
Here's the rocket engine from the Heat 2X rocket that was supposed to have flown in 2014, but due to a mistake in a weld, it failed during a static engine test. 600 liters of alcohol poured out of the bottom of the rocket in a few seconds. And of course, you were still feeding in liquid oxygen from the top, so the alcohol burned outside the combustion chamber in a big fireball. It looked worse than it was. We had to go back to the drawing board and design a new rocket engine that would actually work instead of blowing up. And that's when we built the Nexo 1.
It uses liquid oxygen and 75% ethanol as the fuel. We launched it on the only day of 2016 where the weather in the Baltic was actually good enough to launch. It was perfect weather, very warm, very humid, which is also most likely why we had a malfunction on a valve. We still decided to launch it to be able to get some kind of data out of it. Unfortunately, because of this stuck valve, the rocket engine ran out of fuel.
We are losing power.
Then it fell back down to Earth.
We have a rapid and free fall. Preparation is going on.
It was not a failure because we got data out of it. Whenever you're doing a test, if you don't get any data out of the test, then it's a failure. But if it blows up and you get data out of it, then it's not a failure. Then it's science. Of course it delays the process when you have a setback like a malfunctioning rocket, but it just hardens your resolve and makes you work that extra hard to make sure that it doesn't happen again. It's quite certain that we are going to have more failures. Even the professionals have failures. It happens. Rockets are very, very complex machines. Lots and lots of parts that has to be working perfectly together to perform the required mission.
I would be lying if I told you that everything is just rainbows and unicorns every day, because it's not. The biggest problem is time and money. If you were to compare the way we operate with NASA or ESA or some of the big government agencies, the comparison is absurd, really, because our total annual budget is less than 10% on what NASA spends on coffee for their employees.
It's a different kind of project because, contrary to a normal day job, everyone here works for free. The project itself survives mainly on donations and assistance from mostly private persons that basically believe in the dream that it is possible to go to space as an amateur organization. The Nexo 1 and the Nexo 2 rockets are actually the two first rockets which are on a more well-defined roadmap on how to get to space. So I'm standing right here with the Nexo 2 rocket, which is this year's star. We have the entire engine section down here, which is where we get all the power we need to go to space. Moving up one section, this is the liquid oxygen tank. That's half our propellants. The other propellant tank is this one up here, the fuel tank. The contents of these two tanks, that's what we mix, ignite it, and then it has this very interesting chemical reaction that lets us fly. We have to force our propellants from the tanks into the engines. You can do that with a pump, but we don't have that. This is where we have the DPR section, which is basically a high pressure tank with additional pressurization gas. And that gas is then routed to the two different tanks as the fluid levels drop in those tanks. So we're sort of topping up the tanks with gas, compensating for the fuel that runs out the bottom. This rocket here basically is a flying testbed. It contains all the different systems we're going to have on the final Spica rocket we're going to use to really go to space. But we're testing all this stuff in a much smaller scale. We don't need to go to space to check it and to see if it works. We just need to fly a full flight circle. And if we can get that working on Nexo 2, we're pretty certain it will also work on the Spica rocket.
Building the actual rocket is only 15 or 20% of the effort that is put into launching the rocket. There's loads of work that we have had to put into building launch facilities, support equipment, telemetry, control systems, everything around the rocket. And then as we are launching rockets from sea, we also have our ships that needs to be maintained.
Right now we are on our new mission control ship called Bolette Munkholm. Our entire operation is based upon the fact that we can launch from sea, because Denmark is basically too crowded on land. So we need quite a large exclusion zone around our ships to make sure that our rockets don't hit anybody else when they're coming down, like fishermen or sailboats or stuff like that entering the area. Once you see the thing launch, your heart skips a couple of beats at least. There's nothing quite like it. Seeing something you have spent at least a couple of years building, lifting off, and trying to reach the sky. it's an amazing feeling of accomplishment, which I guess is also one of the reasons why we do what we do.
my first dream, when everybody asks, what do you want to be when you grow up? And it was always, for me, it was astronaut. The reason why I wanted to be an astronaut was because I wanted to feel the physical changes of physical laws that we have here on Earth.
When you have a passion, it's something that is inside of you and that makes you happy and makes you want to spend endless nights and days for this mission. We started off two guys in a garage, and today we are still in a workshop, regular people having regular day jobs, and we are able to build spaceships. -3, 2, 1, Someday the Earth will no longer be here. Someday mankind will no longer be here, and we have to somehow get away from this planet if we want to survive in the very long run. Being an ever so small part of that journey is a very fantastic feeling.
Many of us, instead of dreaming the dream, we now live it. And I don't think we're gonna stop unless the project goes down or we succeed.